Do you stand over your child's shoulder when they do their homework? Do you find yourself directing your kids' every move? Do you spend a good chunk of your day obsessing about your children's success? Like, will they make it to the sports team? Or will they get into the top-notch college you always dreamed of? I'm afraid to say, but you may be a helicopter parent. A term which is commonly used but also has a basis in research on specific parenting behaviors and their effects on children. Most parents want the very best for the children, and so they will go to great lengths to be wonderful providers and protectors. The deep love and care that parents have for the children can even push parents to at times be a bit over the top. And helicopter parents are known to be overly protective and involved in the children's life. The term paints a picture of a parent who hovers over the children, always on alert, and who jump in to rescue them at the first sign of trouble. To talk on this very interesting topic, we have our expert for the day, Ms. Mansi Chawla. Let's welcome her. So can you tell me what this entire terminology, helicopter parenting, is all about? How grave is this situation?
Right, so this can be basically defined by three different types of parents. The first being the kinds who always want to seek information about their child, about where their child is going, what their child is up to, how much time will the child take, even if it is 2 minutes above the time that they have given to come back. They will probably just be capping that time. They're always around helping them make their decisions, fixing their schedules, and wanting the children to follow those particular schedules, and all kind of associated things where they want to just be controlling the child, if you want to give it another term. And then there is another type of parents which have direct intervention into the child's life. So say, for example, if the child has had a fight with one of his classmates or any of the roommates, etc., the parents directly jump into the fights. And then there is also another kind, which is called autonomy limiting, which is when the children themselves feel that they are not able to live life the way that they want to. They are not able to make the choices that they want to, and they're always being controlled by their parents for everything. So these are basically the types of parents who we can include in the helicopter parents. And I understand totally that everybody, all of us, want to give our child the best of everything in the world. But at some points of time, we really don't know when we overdo it. And when I say when we don't know we overdo it, it can also backfire big time on the children as well as the parents because of their own parenting style. And these children are also known to have a lot of extra anxiety issues, depression, and basically their coping mechanism is not that great as a person with any other parent would have, except for a helicopter parent. Yes, that's what it broadly means.
Very well explained, Mansi. Can you elaborate more on the psychological impact this kind of parenting creates?
I'll go with a few studies first. There was one study which was done amongst 300 college freshers, which was surveyed about the level of agreement statements regarding their parents and in terms of their involvement, the parents' involvement in their lives. And surprisingly, 10% of the participants had helicopter parents. These participants were less open to the newer ideas. They were more vulnerable. They were anxious. They were dependent. And they were very, very self-conscious. And another study which was conducted also had this thing where a lot of maladaptive perfectionism from the children came out. That is basically the tendency of the helicopter parents, which made the child be more afraid of taking their own decisions, and hence the child blaming themselves more than any other situation would have allowed them to feel, right? So when we are much in control of our children, at some points of time, we don't draw a line. We don't let them just go out and just get things from the world the way that children should, to be able to have quick responses, to be able to, you know, not always look out for somebody to correct them. And for they don't want to be always told that they are wrong. They become very, very self-judging, And such judgmental actions and reactions of the parents does not help in this sort of a situation. Then there are also very high expectations that are set from the child. At any point of time, if that expectation is not met from the child, the parent also becomes even more judgmental. They start taking them to task for every small little thing. And rather than finding out the solution for their own problem themselves, the child under that judgment is just not able to perform. So their performance can also go much lower in such situations. I've had a lot of clients coming to me and asking me that we are always around the child. We are trying to give the best to the child. Why is our child still not performing? Only if you leave your child with that sort of a capability and strength and give them that kind of courage that they will be able to do things no matter what. And they're not going to be judged even if 100 out of 100 marks, even if they get an 80 or a 90, it would really not matter long term. But that expectation of that 100 to be achieved or a full on full in everything that they need to achieve, that's what puts them under a lot of pressure. That pressure does not let them perform. And then there were also some more studies which were done. It was about 377 students which were put together. And there was a lot of tests which these children had to undergo, the psychological testing, etc., and basically their decision-making skills, academic performance, and the symptoms that they were showing for stress, anxiety, depression, etc. So out of that, the helicopter parents, the children of the helicopter parents showed much higher scores of anxiety and depression. Also, another time there was this puzzle which was given to the children to put the pieces together. The parents there were asked that if they don't help, it's better. But if they want to help, they can definitely jump into the whole thing and help them out. But it was, you know, somewhere where the puzzle started, the children started working on that puzzle. The parents with more of that helicopter parenting style were the ones who started jumping in and started helping those children. Now, what happens in these sort of situations is that the child is not able to put in their own creativity at its best. When they're always being guided, when they're always being helped around by somebody or the other, they can really not be expected to perform to their very best potential. And every child has a little different, they have all very different skill sets. And amongst those skill sets, a child might just be more capable of performing in music rather than performing in painting. And if you ask the child to perform in painting as well as music, his interests somewhere get diluted. And besides just the interests getting diluted, all the results that are going to come out of it are obviously going to get diluted. Yeah, so yeah, this is what it was about this.
So, as I understand it, is that some parents are helicopter parents, but not everyone is, not all parents are. So where does this entire idea of being a helicopter parent comes from? Is it a deep-rooted issue or something that parents underwent, which in turn is reflecting on their parenting style? Can you just throw some light
on it? A lot of times, surprisingly, it is. Mm-hmm. I've had a lot of people coming to me, not only for counseling for their children, but also for themselves. And wherein, out of the very first few questions itself, I always like to ask them that, what was your parents' style of parenting you? Or what were the things that you went through as a child, which is probably, you know, there's some of the other places, some mirror imaging of the parents that they would pick up. And those things, when they pick it up, they always mirror that ahead as well. And there have also been some times, and especially I've seen this a lot in families where the parents are in some job. That's where it comes up more, because they always tell their child that, see, you don't belong to business family. The parents are not going to hand over something to you to just go sit in a shop and just do things. and get your monies automatically. You are the ones who have to build yourself up, study hard, build yourself up, get some good education and some good jobs ahead so that you're able to fulfill those goals that you have and we have for you. So it does definitely, there is a lot of correlation between the way the parents had seen their parents being and also their own expectations, some things which they have not been able to achieve. A lot of us also blame ourselves at times that had we studied this or had we studied a little harder in school or in college, we would have probably been able to make something out of ourselves, and we want our child to do that as well. But we don't know where to draw that line. So that line is very important.
So if we want to draw the line, so how to draw the line? So if we have to create the right balance of not being over possessive, but still trying to, you know, make the kids kind of listen to you and do what, you know, somewhere take you seriously. And, you know, so how to break that over possessiveness and still create the balance? Yeah.
This would depend on a lot of factors. One, that since when has this helicopter parenting been going on? If it has been a very long time, the child in itself has gotten very well adjusted to that particular style of doing things. And if you just tell them that, no, from today onwards, we're not going to say anything. All that you're going to do is going to be on your own. That might not work. So we have to just break it down. We have to get the child used to things. You have to get the child used to being without you at circumstances where the child might need to perform. There will be decisions which the child will need to make. So like the smaller decisions especially are the ones that the children should be allowed to take on their own. If the parent is already used to hovering around the child a little too much. So first of all, they have to stop being around that child a little too much, asking the child to do everything at a particular time, doing, you know, stepping into the homework, asking that kitna homework mila tha, aapne kitna kar liya, and you know, how can I help? If the child is not able to finish the homework, do not step in and do the homework yourself. So when you just start spoon feeding the children a little too much about things, that is where it does not work. Secondly, let them explore. They'll be times when there might just be failures, but failures will be there even when the child becomes a grown-up adult. And the child, it's a very important coping mechanism for a child to be able to learn from his or her own failures and to be able to proceed forward. So small little things, small little changes, one step at a time is what always helps. And don't let your child escape situations as well. You know, there'll be some times when the child will want to escape the situation because the child has already gotten so much used to the anxiety, so much used to that, you know, that fear of not being able to do things, that they might just want to take a little backseat and just, you know, chicken out of situations. At that point of time, what one needs to do is to build their confidence, not break it. By being there for everything for the child, you're not letting that confidence come up. And a self-confident child is definitely going to perform well in not only one aspect of education, but also in the other aspects of life in general. There have also been, you know, there have been times when a lot of people have come to me for their own marital counseling as well. So even when they grow up to be adults who have to be responsible for their own lives and responsible for a family, they still mirror the things which their parents have done. Even being a 50-year-old, one might just be mirroring what their parents have done as probably, you know, good or bad things both. But that also runs in families. And we need to just somewhere create that little separation between the things that are much required and between the things where we think it's a lot of self-introspection which will be required for the parents as well. So introspect wherever you can, come out with the possible causes of your wanting to control your child like that. And don't just get away from, you know, those, don't get away from the responsibilities. the responsibilities of your child are definitely yours to take, and you have to take that forward with you. But it's just a balance that one needs to create to be able to have more creative children around you, to be able to have more self-aware children around you. So yeah, it's just about creating that balance at any point of life that is a possibility to do.
So Mansi, I have asked all my questions. Anything else you want to add? Any kind of advices you have given? Actually, the entire session has been laced with a lot of advices, in fact. Anything specific, any kind of message for the kids who are undergoing this, or those who are borderline?
Children, if they're able to identify that they do have a parent who is hovering around them, and that is what is not letting them achieve what they really want to achieve, it is very important to seek help. And if the child is not able to seek help from within his family environment, it is important to reach out to somebody who the child trusts. The child can open up to the school or college counselors, which are trained to disconnect their emotions from the child and deal with it as an individual case. And also, the children also need to know that there is help around. They just have to voice their opinions or their concerns out. The schools, the colleges, everywhere that they are associated at any particular point of time, have professionals available to help, which will be able to loop in their parents as well if the parents are not understanding. And all these things, all of these sessions are absolutely confidential that they have. The counselor is never going to break that confidentiality clause and go and blurt out everything to the parent, but will be able to explain it in a much better way to the parent that it is causing an impact on the child. It needs to be somewhere balanced out. And things for the parents do not have to be mechanical. The time that the parents really are able to come to that understanding and awareness with a lot of self-introspection, that if they are behaving like this and the child is not very appreciative, or the child has some sort of maladaptive behaviors or functioning patterns, then there could also be something wrong with the parenting. With that kind of openness between the child and as well as their parents, it's going to be magical.
Learning what failure means, how it feels, and how to bounce back is an important part of becoming independent in our world. Parents should, of course, do the best they can for their kids. Impulses to involve ourselves in our children's lives often comes from a sense of duty and of unconditional love. We can still do this and do greater things as parents by resisting helicopter parenting. I would like to say thank you to our expert, Ms. Mansi Chawla, today, who has very beautifully explained every dimension of this parenting style. Thank you, Mansi. Join us next week for yet another topic that concerns every parent. See you all on Super Saturday's Parenting and Beyond. Thank you very much.